course, we gather here tonight and throughout this Newark this week with a heavy heart with the loss of Clem Price, friend to so many of us for so long, for decades. And it is hard for us to imagine Newark without Clem's leadership in giving voice and hope to so many things around Newark. Of course, you know that there will be a visitation at Bethany Baptist on Thursday, and then a funeral on Friday morning, I think at 11 at Bethany Baptist. Clem certainly supported and encouraged us from the beginning when we launched the Newark History Society some 12 years ago. And with each passing day, I at least think of more ways in which we're going to miss him, and the gaps just seem larger and larger and larger. So if we may, if we could start with a moment of silence, each in our own way, recalling our friend Clement Price. Thank you. Our good friend and Clem's good friend, Liz Del Tufo, asked to say something at the start of this program. And Liz, would you like to do that now?
Thank you. Thank you, Tim. Tonight's program is being presented by Thomas Alrutz. You all know Thomas was Tom was formerly director of the Newark Public Library, and he is a trustee of the Newark Preservation and Landmarks Committee, and I am proud to be president of the Newark Preservation and Landmarks Committee, and we're kind of a little known organization here in Newark. We're celebrating our 40th anniversary, and we were founded in the wake of the dark days of 1967, when we were losing our history. I happen to believe that our history, our architecture, is our history. And for any of you, of you who were in Newark in the 1970s, you knew that the fires, the vandalism, the demolition, our history was being destroyed. And we really felt, few of us felt very strongly that the way that the city would survive would be through its history. And we got together with the goal of putting buildings and districts in Newark on the National and State Register of Historic Places. By doing that, we would make it difficult for people to destroy, alter buildings in Newark. In 1986, we were able to persuade Mayor Sheriff James to create the Newark Landmarks Commission, which puts teeth into the committee's work. We raise funds in order to put buildings and districts on the National and State Register, and if anybody wants to do anything to that building or a building in an historic district, they must go through a permit process at the City of Newark. So our 40-year struggle, we have seen a lot of positive things, and we have put over 70 individual buildings on the register and 6 historic districts. So we've protected a lot of Newark's history. And we are not just about buildings, but we also are about people. We were the ones that celebrated Philip Roth's day and put the plaque on Philip's childhood home. We were the ones that he turned to when he celebrated his 80th birthday in Newark. And we were the ones that put a memorial up in Eagles Landing toward the Newark Eagles, Newark's baseball team at the Negro League. and we were the ones that put on the register Dr. Kinney's hospital. Dr. Kinney, the first Afro-American physician to treat African-American patients in Newark. He built his own hospital, and we preserved that hospital. And this evening, we will be talking about Reverend Hayes Ward. Again, a person. We do more than just buildings, but we do the people whose achievements have made Newark such a rich city. And our trustee, Tom Alrutz, of course, did the research on Reverend Hayes Ward. We put a plaque on his house. So we are more than just buildings. And why I am talking to you is because I would like to see you all join our effort. I did put brochures out on the corner, on the table there, so you can read a little bit about us. We have a wonderful website, thanks is to our executive director, Rosalind Nickel. Roz, just stand up and wave. It is a marvelous website, and that's because of Roz's talent. So, anyway, that's my thing.
Thank you, Liz. Just a couple other thank yous before we launch into the program. Certainly a thank you to the city clerk, Robert Marasco, for arranging for the filming of this program. As with all of our programs in recent years, it will be shown at a subsequent date on Channel 78, Newark TV, and then DVDs of that will be deposited with Natalie in the Rutgers Library here in Newark, and also at the Newark Public Library. In just a little bit of a heads up about next year's programs, in, I think, the end of January, we have to sort out the date, but Gail Malmgreen is going to give another update on the Newark Archives Project. I think most of you know that one of the ways that the Newark History Society tries to contribute to and encourage ongoing research into Newark's history is through that Newark Archives Project. Over 2,000 collections have now been described, and she and her crew are just getting to the State Archives in Trenton, so that number will increase. And they just keep finding fascinating material, and she's going to report on that at the end of January. Then in March, Linda Epps, who's not here tonight, at NJPAC, co-sponsored by the Women's Association of NJPAC, will be talking about the Great Migration from the South to the North in the 40s and the 50s. And then we need to firm up the arrangements here, Dr. Parsonet, but we are looking at next May. A program about medicine in Newark with Dr. Parsonet, Beth Israel, the head of St. Michael's, and the head of Barnabas, and that should be a splendid program as well. And then in the fall, a program on Philip Kearny, Civil War general, and Guy, I think we have a program in the end of 2015 on Jerome Kern, who went to high school at Behringer High School, I think. Is that right? So we actually have our programs lined up for the coming year, which is a miracle in and of itself. And then it's on to 2016 and Newark's 350th anniversary celebration, and we are putting our heads together to see what the Newark History Society can do to contribute to that. But tonight, building off what the Newark Preservation and Landmarks Committee did in bringing William Hayes Ward to our attention by adding his remarkable home and house in the Forest Hill section of Newark to the Register of Historic Properties, we asked Tom Alrutz to tell us more about this man, who is somewhat forgotten in Newark, if I can say. But it is, Tom has really brought him to light. Tom, as Liz said, was the director of the Newark Public Library before moving to New York and heading up the Midtown branch of the New York Public Library. And then we were happy to welcome him back to Newark in his retirement. Tom.
Thank you, Tim. Next slide, please. Exactly 1 year ago today, November 10th, 2013, the Newark Preservation and Landmarks Committee unveiled a historical marker on a house at the corner of Abington Avenue and Ridge Street in the Forest Hill Historic District of Newark. Several months before that, Liz Del Tufo, president of the Landmarks Committee, asked me to find out something about William Hayes Ward, who had lived in the house. A quick search turned up information about an interesting man who was involved in many things, all of which he seemed to do well. But it took a lot more searching to discover the significant role that Ward played in the abolitionist movement. Next slide. This is the front of the house on Abington. Next slide. You hit something else down there. He hit another button. This is the side of the house on Ridge Street where the marker has been placed so that it could be close to the street and be available and easily seen by people. The house is set far back and there are a lot of trees and shrubs and you wouldn't be able to see anything. Where this way, passing by on the street, you can see. Next slide. So this is what the marker looks like, actually right close to the street, walking by, you can easily see it. And the next slide. And this is a close-up of Ward on the marker. I am not a historian. My academic background is in philosophy, theology, mathematics, counseling, and library science. I had only my two-semester undergraduate survey course in American history. My skill is in rooting out facts and information about William Hayes Ward. Others with more historical context will have to help place Ward in his rightful place as a notable Newark resident. William Hayes Ward was born in Abington, Massachusetts on June 25th, 1835. He was a descendant of William Ward, who settled in Sudbury, Massachusetts, about 1638. In fact, I'll stop and from my text and say he's apparently not related in any way to the Wards who founded Newark. Yeah. So I traced his whole genealogy from the point of William in Sudbury, and there's nobody in that line who went to Connecticut, and all of the Connecticut people came from, I think, four towns in Connecticut, the Wards in Newark. So there's that question answered. Not in there, answered. His father was James Wilson Ward, for 21 years, pastor of the First Congregational Church at Abington, and a member of the Massachusetts legislature for several terms. His mother was Hedda Lord Hayes, oldest daughter of Judge William Allen Hayes and Susan Lord Hayes of South Berwick, Maine, and niece of President Nathan Lord of Dartmouth College. William was the oldest of their five children. He came from a family of congregational ministers. His great-grandfather, Nathan Ward, was pastor of the colony that founded Plymouth, New Hampshire, and his grandfather, Jonathan Ward, was first pastor in Alna, Maine, and then minister of the First Church of Plymouth, New Hampshire. There was a close relationship between the Ward and Hayes families. All the children of both families were at one time pupils of the Berwick Academy, adjoining the Hayes home. William's mother, Hedda, died when he was 7 years old, so the care and education of the five ward children became the sole responsibility of his father, James. Under his father's guidance, William began the study of Hebrew at the age of six and read through a Hebrew version of the entire Bible between the ages of six and nine. At nine, he began the study of Greek and during the next 3 years read the entire Bible through in Greek. At 12, he began the study of Latin and during the next 3 years read the scriptures through again in that language. This story of William's study of the Bible in three languages, starting at the age of six, seems like it is surely an exaggeration, but we can read about it in William's own words. His father decided that Hebrew was the easiest language, then Greek more difficult, and finally Latin was the most difficult. As an adult, William agreed with his father's assessment. After spending time in various schools, he graduated from Phillips Academy in Andover, Massachusetts in 1852. At 17, William entered Amherst College, concentrating on natural sciences, and from which he graduated with distinction in 1856. After teaching for a short time, he entered Union Theological Seminary in New York, and later transferred to the Sheffield Scientific School in New Haven, Connecticut, and then the Theological School of Yale College. After another brief period of teaching mathematics and sciences at Beloit College in Wisconsin, he entered the senior class at the Andover Theological Seminary in July 1858 and graduated in 1859. In changing from one seminary to another, William was following his father's advice to seek out and study under the best teachers at all three theological institutions. On August 6, 1859, William married Ellen Maria Dickinson, whom he had met during his stay at Beloit College. The American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions rejected his application because of the delicate health of his wife. He then applied to the Congregational Home Missionary Society, and he was sent as pastor of the Congregational Churches at Oskaloosa and Grasshopper Falls, Kansas. That's what it says. Where he and his wife spent 2 years under conditions of hardship and privation. He was ordained on January 8, 1860, by the Middlesex South Association. After his Kansas experience, he resumed teaching the sciences for his living. First at Williston Seminary in East Hampton, Massachusetts in 1861, then at the Free Academy in Utica, New York from 1863 to 65, and finally from 1865 to 68 as professor of Latin and natural sciences at Ripon College in Wisconsin. During these years of teaching, he also carried on his studies in various fields and read widely. He maintained his interest in church affairs, preaching frequently, and becoming active on various church and missionary boards. William and Ellen had one child, Herbert Dickinson Ward, born on June 29, 1861, in Waltham, Massachusetts. In 1868, Henry C. Bowen, the owner and publisher of the Independent newspaper, offered Ward a position on the editorial staff of his weekly newspaper. Ward accepted and moved to New York City. He served as associate editor from 1868 to 1870, as superintending editor from 1870 to 1896, and as editor from 1896 to 1914, and as honorary editor from 1914 to 1916. He was associated with The Independent for almost 50 years. The Independent was established in 1848 by Henry C. Bowen, a New York merchant, as a congregational anti-slavery weekly to promote congregationalism and serve as a voice of abolitionism and later women's suffrage. It was published in New York City from 1848 to 1928 and had a peak circulation of about 75,000 in 1870. From 1848 to 1861, the newspaper was led by a team of three editors, all congregational ministers. In 1861, Henry Ward Beecher, the noted Brooklyn congregational minister and abolitionist, became editor, and Theodore Tilton became assistant editor. In 1863, Tilton became editor and added women's suffrage as another focus of the Independent, along with publishing poetry and other literary contributions. In 1870, Tilton's wife confessed to an affair with Henry Ward Beecher, who was Tilton's lifelong idol. Tilton's leadership of the Independents starting in 1868 was somewhat rocky. Into this atmosphere came the very talented and competent Ward as associate editor in 1868. In 1870, Tilton left his position as editor and Bowen took over editorial control. Ward became superintending editor and began the process of revitalizing the paper. At Bowen's death in 1896, Ward became editor. Ward received the degree of DD from the University of the City of New York and from Rutgers College in 1873, and that of LLD from Amherst College in 1885. Ward's wife, Ellen, died in 1873 when their son, Herbert, was about 12 years old. In 1875, he moved to Newark, residing at, quote, the Stone House, unquote, Abington Avenue, Newark, in what was later variously numbered on Abington Avenue in the Forest Hill Historic District. He commuted daily to his job at the Independent in New York City. The 1880 federal census shows Ward living at his house in Newark with two of his sisters and two servants. His sister, Susan Hayes Ward, was as accomplished as her brother, but took on the task of running the household. She also wrote for and edited at The Independent and succeeded her brother as editor. One of her letters is in the autograph collection at the Newark Public Library, and another is in the special collections at Rutgers University. Ward lived in Newark until his retirement from daily work at The Independent in 1914, a period of almost 40 years. So we have Ward leading an influential abolitionist newspaper in New York City and living in Newark. What was his role and what were his accomplishments as an abolitionist in the Reconstruction era and beyond? After the adoption of the 15th Amendment to the Constitution in 1870, freed people did not enjoy equal status or opportunities, except on paper. Many abolitionists, their children and grandchildren, continued the struggle to convert paper promises into reality. Newark resident, the Reverend William Hayes Ward, was a very important leader in this struggle through the founding of the NAACP as a, quote, new abolition, unquote, organization in 1910. The two books which I used to find out more about the abolitionist movement in the U.S. were both written by James M. McPherson Princeton University Professor of History, and Pulitzer Prize-winning author of many books. Next slide. The struggle for equality tells the beginning of the story through the Reconstruction period. Next slide. The abolitionist legacy moves the tale forward from Reconstruction through the founding of the NAACP. This latter work is based on a study of 284 abolitionists, 47 of whom are listed as important, and 28 of whom are listed as very important. William Hayes Ward makes the very important list. So let's follow Ward in his career at the Independent. In 1875, Ward started writing about the need for black uplift, the need for the government, organizations, society, and people to aid the freed people in their struggle to achieve some semblance of a normal existence, part of the United States of America. He called for support for black uplift. In the election of 1878, he was so concerned about the lack of support for voting rights that he called upon the federal government to consider sending troops in to support the right of the free people to vote. 1883 and 1887, he was encouraged by black progress. The Independent celebrated the freedmen's achievements in the 1880s. They frequently published statistics, case histories, and anecdotes of black success. These examples prove that, considering the condition in which long years of oppression left him, the Negro has done more than well. Ward doubted whether so great a change was ever made on so large a scale with so few evils and such complete success, and questioned whether an equal number of white persons would, in like circumstances, have done better. To get the black viewpoint on Southern conditions, the Independent sent questionnaires to 200 Negro leaders in 1886. The results of the survey, published in early 1887, only slightly dimmed Ward's optimism. Nearly all the replies stressed that property ownership and education were the keys to progress. Ward conceded that wrongs are still numerous and that the indignity of the caste prejudices is bitterly felt. Nevertheless, he was impressed by the growth in education and material well-being and by the spirit of hopefulness among the respondents. The progress of the last 25 years has been marvelous, and another similar period will, we think, find the caste question nearly settled. Ward supports the Blair Bill to provide federal aid for education to the states. Several abolitionists played important roles in supporting this bill, especially William Hayes Ward of the Independent. Ward conceded that Southern spending for schools had risen since 1880, and that enrollment, especially of black students, which doubled between 1877 and 1887, had also increased. But the growth in enrollment had caused a decrease in per student expenditure of nearly 8% between the Depression year of 1877 and the prosperous year of 1887. The Independent showed that the North's per student expenditure was now nearly four times the South's, and the average school term in the North was 70% longer than in the South. Ward on the presidential election of 1888. The Republican Party wanted to play down the race question and concentrate on the tariff question in 1888. In his best evangelical tradition, but while continuing to insist that the caste devil was the masterpiece of Satan, abolitionists and educators admitted that for the time being, segregationist sentiment was so strong in the South that neither logic nor Christianity could overcome it. Although prejudice will, of course, give way in the end, said Ward, we must meanwhile submit to the absurd. But the missionary schools and churches themselves must set an example of biracialism that would show the way toward the final goal of an integrated society. The existence of Southern prejudices, stated the AMA, is no reason why we should not attempt to build up the educational work in the South on true Republican principles. It is well that some white pupils should somehow be secured in every one of our schools, even if special pains have to be taken or inducements offered. All of the missionary schools were open to both races, but few Southern whites attended any of them except Berea. Ward on literacy tests and universal suffrage. In 1890, the principle of manhood suffrage had many abolitionist defenders, especially Ward. We dread these tests of intelligence as a panacea for the ills and dangers of Republican government, said Ward. The fact that a man cannot read is very far from proving that he is not intellectually competent to vote. Ward pointed out that in the North and in Britain, mass education necessarily followed rather than preceded universal suffrage. Ward on lynching. As a cause of abolitionist anguish and protest, even disenfranchisement took second place to lynching. The number of lynchings reached an all-time recorded high of 255, 155 of them black in 1892. Thereafter, the lynching rate declined, but the percentage of victims who were black rose sharply. From 1890 to 1899, the average number of lynchings per year was 188. This declined to 93 in the following decade. But while 82% of the lynchings had taken place in the South, and 68% of all victims were black in the 1890s, these proportions increased to 92% Southern and 89% black in the next decade. Even worse, lynching was becoming less a matter of furtive midnight hanging and more a public spectacle accompanied by torture and carried out by burning at the stake. Even as the rate of lynching declined, therefore, the practice became more visible and vicious. Most of all, it became more exclusively racial, a means of terrorizing black people. It was this that made lynching a major social issue in the 1890s. More than anything else, it was this that deflated the optimism of the 1880s and rekindled the militancy of former abolitionist Ward. The Independent became one of the foremost anti-lynching newspapers in the country. It is impossible to speak with self-restraint on this subject, wrote Ward in 1892. Lynch mobs cared not whether their victims were guilty of any crime. They wanted the sign of blood. They were savages. During the years 1882 to 1927, when an average of about 12% of the nation's black population lived in the North, less than 3% of the Negro lynchings took place there. Yet abolitionist newspapers and orators hurled far more than 3% of their denunciations at these northern crimes, which proved that we are worse than we supposed we were, said William Hayes Ward. In 1901, a lynching described by the Independent as one of the most atrocious in the history of the country occurred at Leavenworth, Kansas. And the infamous lynching at Coatesville, Pennsylvania in 1911, in which a Negro who had killed a policeman was dragged from the hospital and burned alive, shook abolitionists more than any other lynching. Though everyone knew the identity of the mob's leaders, a Coatesville jury acquitted them. Tell it not in Charleston, publish it not in the streets of Atlanta, commented Ward bitterly. What northern state can hereafter criticize Southern leniency toward lynchers? On the future of abolitionism. The failure of some second-generation abolitionists to follow in their father's footsteps and the later conservatism of several first-generation abolitionists should not come as a surprise, since youthful radicalism is often a casualty of age. It is the stern souls that hold fast to obligation who must be depended upon to insist upon political and social rights for the Negro, wrote Ward in 1896. Ward was one of the sternest of those souls, but he had plenty of company. Many kept pressing on. These stern souls came in time to be called neo-abolitionists. Neo-abolitionists insisted that white Southerners, blinded by stereotypes, knew the Negro least. For absolute and colossal ignorance of the Negro of the South, observed Ward, looked to his white neighbors, who never had a doubt that he knows it all. Since Southern whites did not know the Negro and seemed to have learned little since 1861, some former abolitionists, including several who in the 1880s had urged a let alone policy, became convinced that the old tactics of agitation must be revived to teach Southerners the truth. Ward on anti-immigration movement. Most abolitionists condemned anti-immigration and anti-Negro sentiments as twin evils. William Hayes Ward deplored the new know-nothing movement growing out of Anglo-Saxon arrogance. He defended the Southeastern European immigrants. The most progressive country in Europe is Hungary, and the Russians are of magnificent promise. No people have more native genius than the Italians. By welcoming these people, we do ourselves a benefit, for they contributed to the cultural diversity that made America unique. Ward spoke for most neo-abolitionists. On American imperialism, some evangelical abolitionists supported the American acquisition of Puerto Rico and the Philippines as a civilizing force bringing Christianity and Western culture. They envisioned only a temporary possession of these colonies until the natives were educated up to the level of self-government. They supported missionary schools on the islands for this purpose, just as they sustained similar schools for Southern Negroes. Imperialism meant the extension of American liberty and government to the people of other lands, said Ward in 1898. For Puerto Ricans and Filipinos, as well as for the so-called Anglo-Saxon, our trust must be in territorial autonomy, such as we gave New Mexico or Hawaii. We want no colonies to be governed like India or Java. We want territories to be educated into self-government. Fine sentiments these, but they suffered considerable strain when an insurrection against American occupation of the Philippines broke out in early 1899. Ward thought the Filipinos were not yet ready for self-government. He maintained that Emilio Aguinaldo's guerrillas did not represent a majority of Filipinos. He continued to insist that the Philippines must be given the blessings of American liberty, even at the point of a gun. This was a minority position among neo-abolitionists. Ward on Reconstruction. Several neo-abolitionists portrayed Reconstruction as a positive good. They began by attacking the pro-Southern account as a series of exaggerations and falsehoods that only prove, said Ward, that if it's said loud enough or times enough, people can be made to believe almost anything. Ward insisted that Negro suffrage was not only a necessary act of justice, but a magnificent and courageous piece of statesmanship. The Reconstruction governments rehabilitated the war-torn South, inaugurated social reforms, and most important of all, built a public school system. Ward admitted the existence of corruption, but maintained that whites were more responsible for it than blacks. Rejecting romantic racialism and racism. Romantic racialism asserted that the black man's special qualities more than compensated for his inferiority to the dour Anglo-Saxon. Such expressions of romantic racialism could play into the hands of white supremacists who were quite willing to concede to blacks a racial genius for rhythm and gaiety. Nobody recognized this better than Ward, who consistently rejected theories of racial differences. When Dubois published a paper entitled The Conservation of Races, in which he discussed the products of the Negro mind, Ward criticized this idea as nonsense. There is no special difference between a white mind and a Negro mind. Since Dubois was a Harvard graduate, We presume he was a Harvard mind. But Ward rightly considered white racism more dangerous than romantic racialism. He was in the vanguard of the numerous white new abolitionists who defied the racist consensus. There is no slightest evidence that there is a lower level above which the Negro cannot rise, stated Ward flatly. There is no such essential, invincible inferiority. If given a chance, black people would prove themselves equal to the best the world has yet produced. We expect to see men of that blood occupying the highest positions in this country, all conceded Caucasian or Anglo-Saxon assumption and resistance to the contrary notwithstanding. We believe that a succeeding generation will see black republics in Africa producing statesmen, philosophers, poets, and orators worthy to be counted beside Homer and Plato and Cicero and Dante and Shakespeare. Matters of education, culture, character, said Ward, depend not on physical, but on social heredity. A number of American anthropologists began making important contributions to the egalitarian position in the first decade of the century, especially Livingston Foran of Columbia University. Citing one of Foran's articles, Ward rejoiced that it utterly cuts the ground out from under the white supremacist. It is significant that in an age of overwhelming racist consensus, more than three quarters of the white neo-abolitionists took a public stand in agreement with Ward's assertion that notions of racial inferiority were false in science, ruinous in government, and intolerable in morals. On the feebleness of laws, attempts to pass new laws in support of voting rights in the South were not supported by many black leaders and white liberals, and Ward feared that the political rights of the Negro would be even more hopelessly eclipsed than at present. When a total ruling community is determined that a law shall not be enforced or that justice shall not be done, they are sure to nullify any laws, said Ward. Our liquor laws are an example. On Booker D. Washington, the bootstrap theory of racial progress or gradualism was the credo preached by Booker D. Washington. Most neo-abolitionists endorsed Washington's work. Many of them dissented from his emphasis on industrial training or found distasteful his sometimes obsequious praise of Southern whites and his reluctance to speak out strongly against injustice. Washington's address to a mostly white audience at the Atlanta Exposition on September 18, 1895, was more than an event, it was a phenomenon. William Hayes Ward believed that Washington did not say at Atlanta at all, did not say at Atlanta all he felt, for it would not be agreeable or wise. Ward criticized Washington's tendency to avoid all mention of wrongs done to the Negroes by others, and to speak only of those which they do to themselves, either through ignorance, laziness, or vice. Though he continued to support Washington, Ward also began to publicize the words of his black critics and Southern moderates. In 1902, an Emory University professor named Andrew Sled wrote an article attacking lynching and advocating racial moderation. The resulting furor forced him to resign his professorship. The next year, a professor at Trinity College in Durham, John Spencer Bassett, criticized race-baiting demagogues and praised Booker T. Washington as, next to Robert E. Lee, the greatest Southerner of the last 100 years. A majority of Trinity trustees lukewarmly supported Bassett when the headhunters came after him. But 3 years later, Bassett pulled up stakes and moved to the friendlier environs of Northampton, Massachusetts. Though this was hardly an auspicious beginning, neo-abolitionists regarded Sled's and Bassett's articles as harbingers of better times. We see frequent accounts of the better feeling of Southern white people toward their colored brethren, said Ward. The solid, decent, and intelligent middle class are not, we are convinced, in sympathy with such ranters as Senator Tillman. Cooperation between neo-abolitionists and the Southern Education Board, which concentrated on arousing Southern support for public schools, began to break down within 2 years of the latter's founding. In 1902, the board declared its first priority to be the education of whites, since the race problem could be settled only by educated, intelligent white men teaching the Negro to work. This muddled nonsense, said Ward, should be condemned for what it was by those who believe in equal rights and privileges for everybody, equal education and equal work, on gradualism. By 1906, the last shreds of faith in time and education had disappeared for many neo-abolitionists. They shifted their main concern from uplift to protest. Uplift to protest. They began to emphasize the need for social change more than the need for black self-improvement, rights more than duties, opportunity more than preparation. The hope that blacks would earn equality by achievement had proved false. Indeed, the opposite had occurred, for the race steadily lost civil and political rights after 1890, even as its literacy and wealth increased. Ward described as a system of half-truths the philosophy that says to the aspiring Negroes, work, wait, acquire property, be patient, and live decently, for as fast as he approaches this standard, he is thrust back. This one is an important statement, for despite its frequent militancy, the Independent had for 30 years advocating something similar to what it now rejected as half-truth. On Dubois. Next slide, please. Richard. Ward had early contact with Dubois, exchanging information, friendly. He wrote him a letter in 1904, Ward to Dubois, talking about an error that he had found in an article that Dubois had published, and suggesting a friendly correction. He had checked into the nature of this training school, a congregational training school, which will not admit Negroes, found it no longer existed, and it had been for Mexicans speaking Spanish language. So he corrected him. He ends by saying, I was in Atlanta the other night for a few weeks ago and was very sorry that I could not get up to the university. I was only there to attend a meeting at the Colored Congregational Church. So he obviously had interest rapport with him. Ward was born in 35, Washington in 56, and Dubois in 68. Ward came to the Independent in 68, the year Dubois was born. Dubois is the black person heading up the ladder, ready to take over from the old man Ward and become the leader of the movement. He's prepping him. Booker T. Washington infiltrated the ranks of his enemies, used his influence over white philanthropy and patronage to silence his critics, and subsidized part of the black press to control it. Dubois did his best to expose the workings of the Tuskegee machine. In January 1905, he published an article accusing Washington of having subsidized a half dozen black newspapers with hush money. Ward privately asked Dubois to furnish proof of his charges against Washington. Dubois responded privately to Ward. There was no break in the cordial relationship between Ward and Dubois. Next. Much later in their relationship with the end of Ward's time with the Independent, Ward was a poet, Dubois was a poet. The black leaders had nowhere to publish their works. The Independent was one of the few publications that would take works by black. Dubois submitted his poetry to Ward. Ward was a fabulous editor. He wrote to Dubois talking about what he had found and misunderstanding what Dubois meant, and enjoying the repartee between the two talking about poetry. Ward was quite an accomplished editor and poet, and he sent the poem on then to the editors in New York for publication in the Independent, and said he told Dubois that he was working on theological articles and occasional editorial columns for the Independent. The 53 signers of the call for the National Negro Conference in 1906, 16 were one-time abolitionists or their descendants, including Ward. At the conference itself, Ward chaired one of the six sessions, along with three other abolitionist descendants. Ward was chairman of the AMA's executive committee when he took part in the National Negro Conference. The AMA was proud of Dubois as the most illustrious graduate of one of its schools, Fisk University. The American Missionary magazine, published by the AMA, frequently reprinted his crisis articles and endorsed the NAACP's activities. Next slide. Local coverage of the 1909 conference. Headline: Calls Black and White Brain Equal, an Issue. Big subject at the conference. Doctor at New York Conference on Status of Negro Lords' Progress. The so-called National Conference on the Status of the Negro opined in the Assembly Hall of the Chair. Opened in the Assembly Hall of the Charities Building Monday. This again in the Trenton Evening Times, June 2nd, 1909. The speakers were Dr. William Hayes Ward, who presided, Professor Burt Wilder, Professor Livingston Foran. The burden of the themes of all was greater opportunity for the Negro and a recognition of his possibilities of equality with the white man. Mr. Ward said, "The political majority of the South are perhaps honest, if not Christian, in their attitude toward the Negro. They believe that the Negro is something less than man, partly a brute, and they wish to keep him in virtual serfdom." Ward laid this attitude to the still potent influences of the book, Types of Man, which circulated largely before the Civil War and lives in the influences it set in motion. He said that a large portion of the agricultural South was coming into possession of the Negroes, who already numbered more farm owners in Mississippi and Louisiana than the whites. And then he went on to talk about the testimony of the two professors. In 1914, Ward retired as editor of The Independent at the age of 78, but continued to write for the publication. Next slide. This is Ward's picture on the cover of The Independent at the time of his retirement from active editorship. At that time of his retirement, W.E.B. Du Bois took the opportunity to write some words about Ward in The Crisis, the newspaper of the NAACP. Each month, there was a feature called Men of the Month. In March 1914, it featured a full-page picture of Ward. In an article titled An Unswerving Friend, the retirement of William Hayes Ward from the active direction of the Independent marks an epoch which colored people must not forget. Dr. Ward, a Massachusetts man born in the year 1835 and a Congregational clergyman, became in the course of time editor of a widely influential weekly periodical. Ward remained first and last a single-hearted, straightforward friend of human beings, whether white, yellow, or black. He stood for democracy without ifs, and he stood for that social equality which eagerly recognizes ability and character irrespective of merely physical differences. In Reconstruction times, therefore, Ward was a strong friend of the Negro. Neither the jeers and threats of the South nor the coldness of the North moved Dr. Ward. In the face of criticism and probably at much financial loss, the Independent continued to stand absolutely square on the Negro problem. At times, its voice was drowned by clamor. At times, it rang out absolutely alone. But it stood still, and still its venerable white-haired editor cried grimly with the word of ages, "Gott helfe mich, ich kann nicht anders." Martin Luther, "Here I stand," he reversed the two phrases, but it's "God help me, I cannot do anything else." It just took me back when I read that. Martin Luther, quote from the, the German in the crisis. Amazingly intelligent group we got here. This is a record that deserves the gratitude of every American, and Negroes especially should honor Dr. Ward and subscribe to The Independent. It is gratifying to the crisis to number Dr. Ward with its readers. Next slide, please. Obviously, Ward got advance copy of the tribute because it was the March issue of the crisis. And on February 5th, he's writing to Dubois about the his words, or whether it was a proof or whatever. "You may be sure that I was surprised enough to read your extraordinary appreciation in the crisis of my sympathy with the colored people, Negroes and others. It is more than I deserved, but I have inherited from my father." Ward is a second generation abolitionist. "In the succession of Liberty Party, Free Soil, and the Better Republican principles have been dear to me. As a small boy, my father would go to hear John Quincy Adams make political speeches and was proud to say that he was his representative in Congress. He was proud of the man who introduced anti-slavery resolutions into Congress." "I am very glad that you are editing The Crisis, and you are doing it admirably." So, and he goes on to talk about more things that he's reading and exchanging information. But Dubois gave him an absolutely glowing review. Ward moved from his home in Newark to his mother's family home in South Berwick, Maine, after retirement in 1914. A carriage accident in the summer of 1915 brought on paralysis of the arms, from which he never fully recovered. His strength began to fail, and for 5 months before the end, he was quite helpless. Ward passed away peacefully on August 28, 1916, at the age of 81, and was buried at Berwick, Maine. Ward's picture again appeared on the cover of The Independent. Next slide. Next one, one more. It's his gravestone. In The Independent issue on the passing of William Hayes Ward, William Sanders Scarborough, a freedman, a black classicist, specialist in Latin and Greek, and the president of Wilberforce University in Ohio, took the opportunity to write the obituary for Ward. "With keenest sorrow, I learned that a valued personal friend and friend of the Negro race has passed to the great beyond, and I gladly accept the invitation to give a brief appreciation of Dr. William Hayes Ward's work for the Negro. He has virtually devoted his life to the interests of the race, to its emancipation, to its education, to its struggles, to its ambitions, to its possible future, without a particle of prejudice. Believing that God made mankind all of one blood, and that the Negro should have free enjoyment of the rights and privileges of any human being and of any American citizen, Dr. Ward arrayed himself always on that platform and fearlessly fought the battles of a weak and defenseless people. Proscription, segregation, mob violence, lynchings, denial of vote, all race distinctions, all the 1,001 indignities, persecutions, and cruelties and crimes against the Negro wherever practiced, had found in him one who denounced vigorously and unsparingly all such as unlawful, unjust, unchristian, and inhuman. His work did not stop with his strenuous endeavors to right the wrongs done the Negro, but he maintained that the education of the race should be of the highest type. Declared and demonstrated in its intellectual capacity through many Negro contributions to The Independent on all lines of thought, and encouraged all its ambitions and aspirations as a people. Everything connected with the race won his personal interest, and he never wavered in his allegiance. Public opinion never warped his convictions, nor did his personal interest ever cause him to swerve from the course he deemed right in regard to the race. There was no mere sentimentalism in this. He was a humanitarian of the most royal type, espousing our cause because he believed it a just one, and because we were lowly, weak, defenseless, and friendless. So his warm heart, his keen brain, and his facile pen have united for over 50 years to declare through the Independent and every other possible channel that he was the Negro's staunch friend. The Negro people have lost a most noble, loyal champion, one they will ever hold in grateful remembrance. May his mantle rest upon and forever enfold the Independent. Next slide. His grave says, "Teacher, educator, friend of the Indian, defender of the Negro, promoter of church unity, Orientalist, poet, interpreter of God, follower of Christ," and he was all of these and more, and he did it all very, very well. Next slide. This is a picture of a Ward painting which hangs in the chapel of Amherst College, his alma mater. He served on the board of trustees of Amherst for many years. Ladies and gentlemen of the Newark History Society, I am pleased to have presented you with a very brief introduction to a most remarkable man, William Hayes Ward, Newark's unknown abolitionist. Thank you for your attention.
Are there questions for Tom? If you read about William Hayes Ward, he really touched on the smallest part of the man because he had so many other attributes, but it's good to focus in this way. Yes?
My question is about the optimism of the 80s that Ward and many abolitionists felt about the situation of black people in the South. And today, most historians agree that the reversal of the gains of Reconstruction began in the 70s, and that by the 80s, black people were in retreat from the Klan, other forms of violence and intimidation, and the beginnings of the segregation system. And I'm wondering why it was so different for people who cared so much, who were living through this, from the way we look at it today. Was it because of their belief in gradualism and in uplift that they overlooked the negative things that were
happening? It had been such a long struggle to get to that point. They had made some progress. Reconstruction seemed to be doing things right. And we just needed to follow through and do it, the gradualism. And they kept preaching that and hoping for that until it fell apart when things got really bad. But it took them a long time to admit that. Many of the abolitionists fell away, said it's taken care of, it's all gonna just follow, play itself out, and that's it. So Ward was in the group who was thinking that, but he stayed right on the case. And when things started moving in a different direction, he moved right in and rallied people around him, got them strongly in favor, and of being able to see the formation of the NAACP, a black organization that could take on the fight and move it with white support participation, with a black spokesperson in the face of Dubois, that hopefully that would be the way to the final step.
Yeah, the newspaper Independent, I assume, when did it cease publication?
It was in New York until 1928. Mm-hmm. It merged with another paper while it was still in New York, and later merged with three other papers, including Harper's Weekly, and the editorial offices were moved to Boston. And in my folder, I have the date, which I would have to look up to tell you, because I traced the whole genealogy of it to see before it finally went out of existence. So there were many, many newspapers and magazines of that type, and they all started having trouble and they were merging. I guess when they when it closed, there was five or six that had merged together with offices in Boston and around. So 28 was its last time in New York when it merged with one other magazine, but it was still the Independent.
You might have said this, but where is he buried?
Berwick, Maine, in his mother's family estate. His mother's family home he had purchased a year before he retired to have a place to go to retire, where he had grown up, and right next to Berwick Academy, where he and all of the Hayes and Ward people had gone to school. And he lived in that house for the last 2 years and then was buried there. And the house was now the headmaster's house of the adjacent Berwick Academy.
Tom, did you find much evidence of his engagement in things around Newark? And this was the 1890s, 1910s, were such a progressive period in Newark. Were either he or his sister involved in local Newark things?
He is listed in the abolitionist lexus as a resident of New York. Smack, 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 smack. So I find very little evidence of him. His sister, who was in the house, was much more of a Newarker, did many more things. There's lots more evidence of her in Newark and in New Jersey, but not too much. He was so involved with New York. But I'm sorry that we don't have the early papers of the founding of the Newark branch of the NAACP to know where he was in that. Surely, I mean, every year the crisis recounts the story of the founding. Dr. William Hayes Ward presided. It's in the crisis, and every anniversary of the NAACP, every 25 years, the story is repeated. I saw it when I looked through. It's there, it's there, it's there, but nobody seemed to recognize that he was a 40-year Newark resident.
Can you say he was more of a writer and intellectual than he really worked with, say, politicians in Trenton or Newark or New York? Was it more of a writing on the issue of, more of a national group than, say, he really gotten down to the really working with politicians and getting stuff done?
Yeah, he was a national figure in dozens of areas. He was looked to for
not really getting down to the
not political.
More like writers today, like the editorial page.
So he was a writer, a speaker, a preacher. He gave a fabulous speech, which I started exploring, at the centenary of a church in Wellesley, Massachusetts, in which he attributes the whole beginnings of the abolitionist movement to the evangelicals of New England. And it's beautiful. It's really most impressive. What were the threads that brought this about? And he outlines it. So he was a New Englander by background, 40 years in Newark, but he was from those roots, and he went back to those roots. Yes?
Just as a point of interest and also a question, the first African-American to vote under the 15th Amendment in 1870 was a gentleman by the name of, but he's known today as Thomas Mundy Peterson. His real name was Thomas Henry Peterson in Perth Amboy, New Jersey.
So all right.
Another New Jersey first. In Perth Amboy at that time, there was a pocket of abolitionist progressivist sentiment centered around something called the Eagleswood Academy by Marcus and Rebecca Spring. In your research, have you come across any kind of contact that Ward or his sister might have had with them, since they seem to have been very much of the same mind?
No, I don't know why, but I do not. No mention of that. I have millions of other things, but I never saw that one. I would have put it in my talk if I had seen it. I looked for every little Newark and New Jersey connection I could find. Okay.
Well, again, let's say thank you.
Well, thank you all for coming. If you are not on our mailing list, let me know. I'll write down your address, and we'll keep you in the loop on what we're doing. We will gather again at the end of January, with the date to be set with Gail when we actually sit down with her, to hear more about the discoveries that the Newark Archives Project has made, and then on in March 17th with Linda Epps. And we will see you then. Thank you.